Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
What if you decide after you determine who's going to be that power of attorney that, gee, that wasn't such a great decision? Can I revoke my decision and choose someone else or just take them off the document?
Yes.
How would I do that?
Well, you can always revoke your power of attorney, right? However, there is going to be a provision in that power of attorney that says that, well, there's probably going to be a provision that says that the revocation has to be in writing, but there's definitely going to be a provision that says that any third party dealing with the person who presents them with that power of attorney is going to be held harmless if that third party doesn't know that you revoked the power of attorney.
Oh, okay.
Right? And that's you can understand why that would be true,
sure.
Because otherwise, once again, I give you my power of attorney, you go to the bank teller, and the bank teller says, well, how do I know this hasn't been revoked? What can you say?
Right.
I promise it hasn't been revoked. You know, it's nothing you can tell,
right?
And that's why, in order to get that bank teller and I'm not picking on bank tellers, but that happens to be where the powers of attorney are used the most, is for someone going to the bank. So if to make that bank teller comfortable, right, there needs to be a provision in the power of attorney that says that he or she can rely on the fact that you have this power of attorney, right, in to count on the fact that they can give you the money without being worried that he or she or their bank is going to get sued.
Does it ever expire? Do you have to update it, or if it's the same person that you've chosen?
You can put an expiration date on the power of attorney. Otherwise, technically, they never expire.
Okay.
Which leads to that common question or the common comment that I'll get from folks. Oh, I have a power of attorney, and I'd say, well, when did you do it? Oh, about 1995. You know. Now, see, you're a young person, so you don't think that was a long
time. That wasn't that long ago.
Right. That was a long time. So I'd say 1995. Well, once again, put yourself in the position of the bank teller, right? And you're going in to take care of your mother's or your father's account, you know, and you're going up with this power of attorney that says 1995, and the bank teller says, no, this is, how do I know this hasn't expired? This is just really old, you know? It's for that reason that what I advise clients to do, once again, because it's inexpensive, right, is if you have a power of attorney that's more than 5 years old,
update.
Get it done again.
Yeah.
Just get it. Just so that you have a new date.
Right.
And that the paper isn't yellow. You know.
That makes sense.
Yeah. That's kind of a bad idea.
I feel comfortable
mm-hmm.
listening about the power of attorney. I don't know that I have any other questions I can think of right now. Regarding the power of attorney.
Let's talk about healthcare proxies a little bit, because we both deal with those issues all the time.
Right. And I mean, I have a healthcare proxy. I was asked at the hospital, who do I want as a healthcare proxy? And I just put the name down of my husband, and it's at the hospital, you know. He didn't sign it. I just said, that's who I want.
That's who you want.
So what's that all about?
So a couple of things about healthcare proxies. First, the reason why you want a healthcare proxy. If you don't have a power of attorney, anyone that needs to deal with any of your assets needs to go and become a conservator, go through the probate process. If you don't see anybody that needs to make medical decisions on your behalf has to become your guardian. Has to go through the probate process again. It used to be that guardians, by the way, could do both of these things, could make these kind of physical decisions and also could make legal and property decisions. That changed a couple of years ago. You actually now, when you're going through probate, if someone is disabled, have to go through two completely separate processes and get two different determinations, right? One regarding conservatorship and one regarding guardianship. So the cost has gone up significantly for going through that process. So you want to avoid that process. So that's what the healthcare proxy is kind of about. Now, The one that you signed when you were at the hospital, right, and that they always tell you they want you to sign, what you probably don't know is that if you had ever had a more detailed healthcare proxy done, you just revoked it by signing that little short form that they had at the hospital. Every time you sign a healthcare proxy, you are revoking all of your previous healthcare proxies. It's like signing a will, right?
I bet a lot of people don't know that.
No. Folks also assume when they go to the hospital and they sign one of these healthcare proxies that the hospital has saved it, right? Typically, hospitals don't,
right?
They don't save healthcare proxies because they just want it for the period of time that you're in the hospital, because they want to make sure if you go into a coma, if something happens, if you become disabled, they want to know who they can talk to make sure they can get decisions made, right? So what you probably want is a healthcare proxy that would survive all of those decisions and all those trips to the hospital. So you probably want a healthcare proxy which is more detailed than what you've got in the hospital, right? And that you can keep using. Now, the person that you want to have to give that healthcare proxy to is your doctor, your primary care physician. Because if you get picked up in an ambulance and someone's looking at your file of life or otherwise trying to find out what your medical decisions are, or if they call the hospital is going to call your primary care physician, right? That's the place where your healthcare proxy should be located, so that your PCP, your primary care physician, can email that proxy to the doctor or otherwise take care of it, right? So that the doctor is going to know, who really is your proxy. Now, a couple of other things I just want to mention before we close about healthcare proxies. Once you've signed a healthcare proxy, it does not automatically go into effect. It only goes into effect when your doctor determines in writing, that you are incapable of making a medical decision, right? It stops being in effect as soon as your doctor says that you're okay. So it's only in effect during that limited period of time. You can also revoke your healthcare proxy at any time. Even if your doctor doesn't think that you're competent to revoke the healthcare proxy, you always have the ability to revoke the healthcare proxy. So when you're signing one, it isn't like you're signing your life away, right? Or that you're losing all of your power to make medical decisions that you would normally have the power to make. You're only guaranteeing that in an emergency, these issues are going to be dealt with.
When I worked as a social worker, the point I made to folks is to please tell your healthcare proxy what you want done.
That's right.
Now,
does that
have to occur, or can the person write exactly what they want done in the healthcare
process? And I know that we're a little bit limited on time, but the way that should be handled, the so-called living wills or instructions to the doctor regarding how one should be treated are not enforceable in Massachusetts.
Okay.
So what you want to do is you want to tell your proxy, either in writing, right, or verbally, you want to give them instructions on how you would want to handle medical emergencies so that your doctor can rely on your proxy's advice for this.
Great.
Thank you
Thank
very
you.
Much. Those were great
very
questions.
Very informative.
You ever think about being a lawyer?
No.
So thank you very, very much for watching today. I hope this information has been informative to you. We're going to be having later episodes of Bergeron Briefs. We're going to be talking some more about Alzheimer's and some more about late stage and how to stay at home even if you've got late stage dementia, and about a number of other legal issues. Thanks. We'll see you next time.